Hello, my name is Eberhard. In this video we will take a look at different ways to set up a C++ project for Sourcetrail. Most of this also applies to C projects. I will use the Cinder library as a sample project, which is a library for creative coding in C++ involving graphics, audio and video. First I will clone this project to my local file system with Git. Then we make sure we can build Cinder. You can only properly index a project with Sourcetrail if you are also able to build it on the same machine. We just follow the CMake build instructions from the website. Alright, this worked out fine. Now let's try to set up a Sourcetrail project for Cinder. For that we need to create a new project. First we have to enter a project name. Let's call it Cinder. Then we pick a project location. This is where all Sourcetrail project files will be stored. Usually that's the project file and the database file. We pick the root directory of the project. If anything is unclear in the UI, then you can find help information by clicking these question mark icons. Now we need to add at least one source group to our project. Every Sourcetrail project consists of one or multiple source groups. A source group defines a certain set of files and additional information for correctly indexing them. On the left you can choose the language. Currently C++ is selected. These are all options for setting up a C++ source group. First, there is empty setup, which needs the most configuration, but is often the last resort. We will get to it later. Try to use any of the other options first. Then there is setup from a compilation database, which is the easiest way. A compilation database is a JSON file containing a list of all source files in the codebase and all necessary information to build them. The great thing is that you can export it from CMake using the CMake export compile commands flag. After adding the flag and rerunning CMake, we see that this compile commands.json file is now in our build directory. Sometimes this file is already exported by default, so check your build directory if the file is already there. As already mentioned, the file contains a list of all source files and all information on how to build them. If you can't generate the compilation database this way, then there are other options as well. On macOS or Linux you can try using bear or build ear, which simulates a build to create the compilation database file. If you use Visual Studio on Windows, then you can use our Sourcetrail extension to export the compilation database of your solution directly from within Visual Studio. Now let's go back to Sourcetrail and select the compilation database option. First we need to pick our compilecommands.json file. Now we can have a look at all source files located in the compilation database. We see that this list not only contains files of the Cinder library, but also source files from third-party libraries located in Cinder's source directory. Since we are not interested in those libraries, we can exclude them from indexing. Now we can see that only the source files within the Cinder directory are left. As already mentioned, the compilation database only contains the source files. That's why we also need to specify which header files should be indexed by Sourcetrail. Sourcetrail doesn't index all included header files by default, since there is usually no point in having all this information and slowing everything down. Sourcetrail picks some default directories, based on your project directory and the header search paths in the compilation database. But let's clear those again. Usually, the simplest approach is to just add the root directory of the project. Then every included header file that is within this directory will be indexed. But since we are not interested in all the third-party library headers, I'm just going to pick the cinder directory in the include directory, so only those headers will be indexed. And with that we are done. Sourcetrail will provide us a summary of all options. We can see that there are also additional options for extending the configuration of the compilation database. I will explain them in detail when we look at setting up an empty source group later. Now let's create our project and start indexing. This will take some minutes until finished. The indexer finished with no errors. We can see that all indexed files are complete and we can start browsing the project. As you have seen, the setup from compilation database is quite easy. Now let's take a look at manually setting up an empty C++ source group for cinder. We start again by choosing New Project from the menu and entering name and location of the project. Now we choose empty C++ source group for our source group type. First, we can select the C++ standard and also optionally set a target for cross-compilation. This is only required if the source code you index is not compiled for the platform you work on, like in embedded systems programming. We just skip this. Now we need to choose which files and directories will be indexed. We choose the cinder source directory, so all source files inside of it will be indexed. To also index the header files located in the include directory, we need to add that directory as well. Clicking on Show Files will provide us a preview of all source files to be indexed again. In the next step, we need to take care about header search paths to resolve all include directives in the code. The global include paths list contains header search paths shared between all projects. They usually contain the paths to your C++ standard library. This list should get prefilled automatically. Check if the list is correct in case you get errors that standard headers like memory or functional are missing. Your project-specific include paths need to be added in the first list. This process can be quite cumbersome, so we automated some parts of it. When validating all current include paths, we can see which include directives cannot get resolved in our source files so far. This check is not 100% accurate. It does not take care about any if-def guards in the source code. Now we can use the auto detection to find the included header files. The index directories are added by default. Let's just add the root directory so that any included header within it will be found. And after running the auto detection, we see that those paths are detected to be correct include paths. So let's add them. When rerunning the validation, we can see that a lot less headers are missing now. We will continue for now. Later the indexer will tell us which headers are really still missing. The next step is framework search paths, which is macOS only. Frameworks are a container format for packaging different versions of headers and binaries of a library for easier reuse. They are usually passed to the compiler using the F flag. Here you can add directories of frameworks you use in your project. There is also a global framework search paths list for system frameworks such as Foundation or Core Location. Lastly, you can also directly add compiler flags which will be passed to the indexer. Any flag compatible with the Clang compiler frontend is possible. This is also the place to pass preprocessor defines. For example, we could add the preprocessor define tracing enabled. But let's remove it again. We are done with source group setup now. Sourcetrail will provide us a summary on all options again. And after clicking create, we can start indexing. After just a few files, we see a lot of errors. We can interrupt the indexer to take a look at them. These error messages are standard Clang compiler front-end error messages. You can click on them and see their location within the file. To fix them, we need to fix the configuration of our source group. This usually involves a couple of iterations. A good start is to check whether we can get some information out of the build system or compiler. For example, we can display verbose output while building with the V flag. So I will run make with the B flag to force a rebuild and pass V in the CXX flags. Now we can see which commands are used to compile each source file, and I will interrupt this now. First, we can see that there are two defines passed to the compiler. Let's add them to the compiler flags. Then we can see that the used C++ standard is actually C++ 14. Let's change that as well. Lastly, we can see that some files use this X Objective-C++ flag. This means that the project is mixing C++ and Objective-C. If this flag is missing, it will cause a lot of errors. So let's add it to our compiler flags as well. Sourcetrail will warn you that any changes to the project configuration need a full project refresh. But we can also just reindex all incomplete and non-indexed files. Incomplete means that they are affected by errors. All correctly indexed files are not indexed again. So this speeds up the process a lot. Now we get a lot less errors, but we can see that there are errors in files related to WinRT and Linux. Apparently the indexer is trying to index some files for other platforms that are located in our source directory. Let's exclude those files from our index. Now the indexer finishes with only a couple of errors left. We can see that most of the files are complete. Incomplete files still have some information missing due to errors. Depending on the code base, it might not be important to fix all errors. But if possible, try to fix all fatal errors, which can cause a lot of missing information. When browsing the code, we can see that incomplete files have a file icon containing an X in the graph and code view. When selecting an incomplete file, you can click on the Show Errors button to see which errors caused this file to be incomplete. As you have seen, setting up an empty source group is a lot harder than from a compilation database file, so check if you can use the compilation database option first. A great thing about the compilation database is also that it stays up to date with your build environment, so you won't have to update your Sourcetrail project if anything changes. In summary, setting up a Sourcetrail project can be a little work, but Sourcetrail saves you a lot of time during exploring and maintaining your codebase, so it is well worth the effort. Thanks for watching.